Hello YouTubers! In this video, I want to move a bit away from Doom and focus on some aspects of the 3DO CEL engine. At first, I will try to explain how the set of three vectors shown in my previous videos are related to the way the bitmap is stretched onto the screen. Then I will talk about the unique way 3DO renders CEL bitmaps and show you how this can produce some bizarre shapes, which however presents a performance bottleneck not typically found in most renderers. This could be the start of a new series of videos focused on interesting aspects I'm discovering while programming for the 3DO. Before we start, I'd like to explain a few terms related to 3DO that I might have been using interchangeably in my previous videos without being precise enough about the definitions. I wish to be more consistent when using the terms from now on and trying to introduce them in a way that they are used in the 3DO developer docs. A term that is used quite frequently is that of a cell. A cell can mean the individual bitmap plus some additional information we are passing to the hardware to render it to the frame buffer. In the docs you will also hear the term cell engine, which denotes the hardware process by which the GPU reads a cell bitmap and then does the transformation to the screen. The data structure used to tell the CEL engine how to stretch the bitmap onto the screen is called CCB, which stands for CEL Control Block. This is where we pass, for example, the three vectors necessary to describe the bitmap stretching we want. This structure, by the way, provides way more information than just that, from color operations for blending and flat shading, to flanks affecting the screen clipping or polygon order visibility. I would need several videos to describe most of the interesting stuff, but we'll stick to the scaling vectors for now. In order to be able to show you how the CEL vectors work, I will have to switch to a very low res texture of 8x8 pixels. That's because the vectors are very small and relative to the scale of each individual texel, so it's easier to display them over the bitmap when the texels are huge. Let's also bring up the mapped cell as it appears on the screen and check how its vectors relate. The position vector denotes the corner on the screen where the cell rendering starts from. This relates to the very first pixel of the first row of the bitmap in memory, in this example typically displayed as the upper left corner of the bitmap. The way the cell is displayed on the screen right now is upside down, and this is how each pixel of the bitmap in memory relates to what is displayed on screen. This is controlled by the rest of the vectors, for example here the X component horizontal vector HDXI, noted in yellow, has positive value 64, which moves to the right of the screen starting from the red corner point. And the Y component of the vertical vector VDXY, noted in green, has minus 64, which goes upwards in the screen. Thus, we read the bitmap cell serially from upper left corner, but end up displaying it from down to up, left to right on the screen. The rule is that we always read every pixel of the bitmap serially in memory, pixel after pixel, row after row, but how this will be displayed depends on the CCB position and vectors. You might have noticed that these two vectors match exactly the size of a single texel on the screen. This is 64x64 pixel in our case. One other thing that I should mention here is that the position and vectors are saved in fixed point numbers, where the integer part is typically one pixel unit, while the fractional part goes into sub-pixel territory. In the case of the position and the basic horizontal and vertical vectors, it's not necessary for this tutorial to display the full numbers. And the reason actually is also to make things simple for you, because I don't have space to fit the whole number. However, I have included the fractional part for the case of the special vector in blue, which I separated in two components, HDDX and HDDY, in order to be able to fit the numbers. These are much smaller and very frequently go into subpixel values. Just for the numbers, the position in the vertical vector is 16.16 bits, while the horizontal vector in the special HDDXY vector, which affects the horizontal vector, is of size 12.20 bits, so of higher precision. C So, anyway, going back to our example, these two vectors show how to linearly scale the bitmap at a stable rate per pixel. Scaling the vectors or rotating them will let us fully control for zooming and rotating sprites. The vectors are perpendicular here. What would happen if I move the x component of the vertical vector a bit? Not what you expected. It pushed the upper right side to the right too, producing a shearing transformation. Why is that? It's because the horizontal vector hasn't changed, still moves at the same stable rate for every scan line. Would you expect only the upper left corner to translate and the right side corner to stay still? That would be not valid, as it would have changed the horizontal scaling rate as it goes up. Then, how can anyone do arbitrary polygons of any shape with a 3D OCL engine? That's where the special vector in blue with components HDDX and HDDY come to play. And as I have already revealed in my words, what they actually do is affecting the yellow horizontal vector as we move up to the next bitmap line. Let's play with it a bit. I might have to zoom in for a while since the vector is quite smaller than the rest. So what this blue vector does is that it gradually alters the basic horizontal vector as it advances in the next bitmap row. So in a simple scan line, the horizontal vector moves in fixed steps, but its step is altered as the vertical vector moves to the next row. And we can even alter the vertical component of this vector, effectively forcing the upper right hand corner in our examples to any arbitrary position we want. And here's where the fun comes. What happens if we set the vector in some absurd position? For example, I want to move it too far to the left. Reaching this point, we get the so-called degenerate triangle, an actual way to render triangle meshes in 3DO, but you end up with ugly squished textures. Let's go a bit further, however, and we get a bow tie. What if we force the end corner reach the starting lower left corner? Yes, we get these bizarre curves, and it totally makes sense if you think of how the vectors interact with each other. An important point of how the CEL rendering works, according to the manual and even some patents on 3DO I found, is that there is an initial step where, based on the position in the three vectors, a set of grid points is calculated, one grid point for every pixel of the bitmap. This will typically match one of the fourth corners of each texel on the screen, and this depends on where the starting corner position is and where the direction of the vectors are. From these points, a grid is formed, and the CEL rendering in a second stage tries to flat fill them with the individual color of each bitmap pixel. A process that seems very unoptimal to me, but judging from experiments, the docs and the patent and everything I have read, it seems that this is the way they are doing it. They even state in the patent that this is a very expensive pass, and they really do find the left and right extents of each texel scan line by walking through the edges and then horizontally filling between, like your typical scan line renderer, but for every individual texel. There are some additional tricks, like how in some cases they will bypass this process and splat individual pixel when the scale of the bitmap can be approximated to be roughly smaller than 1. So there is no point anymore to draw individual quads. Or how they have additional buffer to temporarily denote the pixel already covered in case there is transparency enabled, so as to avoid overdrawing and blending the alpha or something. There's much more interesting information beyond the point of this video, which I may learn more and talk in the future video or in my blog, we'll see. One more thing that proves the case is that there is a special flag in the CEL data structure that tells the hardware to only render the grid pixels and avoid filling them, which is curiously named Maria. And this is actually used in few games, notably Total Eclipse, where an enemy is destroyed and they draw a bitmap cell of the enemy, zoomed in, but disabling the feeling of the texture, so you see something like exploding dots. But when emulators didn't implement this, it looked like this. Oh, and by the way, this is how Doom looks with Maria enabled. And that's all for this video. I only didn't go talking into detail about the performance bottleneck that this way of rendering introduces. The fact that this forward rendering process where the 3DO creates this grid by reading every pixel of the bitmap and tries to fill texel by texel makes things very slow when one uses high-res textures. That's why you will see some games, like the one I'm playing right now, switching the textures of the faraway cells to low-res bitmaps, something akin to MIP mapping or texture loading, but quite more crude here, and quite more important for performance. I have seen it in some games, although not everybody does it, and you can still get a proper frame rate with okay textures sometimes. I might do a follow-up video at some point about my performance investigations and the rest of the bottlenecks I get into as I continue programming for this console. See you next time!